In this case, now we have the prep done. We've got the pulp covered, or the pulpal dentine covered with some flowable so that it is protected from, you know, air abrasion, anything else. We're not likely to kill the pulp at this point. And we wanted to get that covered as soon as possible, because the sooner you get the pulpal area or the thin dentine over the pulp covered, the more likely the tooth is to survive and have no problem. So here I've now beveled the enamel, and I did that after. So you'll notice I did that pulpal covering. There was bond everywhere. I then beveled the enamel, which got most of the bond off, and then I've sandblasted the external surface of the tooth and the bit covering the pulp. It doesn't really matter. But I've sandblasted everything with no risk of damaging the pulp. I'm only worried about that if the dentine's thin. Now we're drying all of that etch off. The etch is just for the enamel, and it's just to make the enamel, make sure that we get no staining. Any sort of contamination of the enamel is one of the main causes of stain. So I like to use self-etching primer and bond. So I'm using SE Bond 2. You see the self-etching primer there. We'll dry that off, and then we go in with the bond afterwards. We've used it for years. Super good for getting low rates of post-op sensitivity and so forth. Okay, and then we're going to thin that down. You don't really want super thick layers of bond, because if you have super thick layers of bond, that layer of unfilled resin is prone for staining. So going to cure. And now what you'll see here is I'm building up a little bit of a hip, okay? A little area where we can put a wedge against it and put a matrix. So right now the restoration is actually quite subgingival, and even though the rubber dam doesn't show, like the rubber dam is kind of hiding that, we've got a very subgingival restoration. And so if I don't put that little hip there, then when I go to put the matrix in later, there'll be nothing to hold it in place and nothing to wedge it against, because it's too subgingival. So I'm doing a centripetal buildup. That's where you do the dentine layer first, and you build it out as much as to the right size, and then you just cover the entire thing with the enamel layer. Now, what's pretty quickly evident as soon as I start putting this in, and there's no matrix here yet because it's the dentine layer, is that it's gray, okay? So you can see there, I've started putting it in, looks awful. So we don't continue, we just take it out. And it's very important to understand that this happens a lot when you're experienced. You go to do something and you go, hey, that's not working, you just quit. So now we are getting some opaque resin, and we're going to cover that dark area. So even though I put flowable on, that regular flowable won't cover the blackness. So now we're just putting some dark, opaque resin over the top, and the opaque resin is covering that black dentine. So now you'll see when I put this dentine shade in, now it doesn't have that super gray look, because the blackness of that dentine is now covered. Okay, so now it can form like a dentine layer without looking super black or gray. And we're just going to basically make it the size of the dentine part of the tooth. So we're not making it full size. It's not covering the margins. We don't want it at the margins, because it's so opaque. Once it's at the margins, it's going to show through as like a line. So we're just making sure there's space to put a whole enamel layer. This is like the centripetal buildup. If you want to do palatal shells and then dentine, that's fine too. This is kind of the more simple technique for simple folk like me. So we'll cure that layer, and then we're going to need to fix the hip. So we're going to pull out that matrix, and there's going to be some roughness there because we used a wooden wedge. And now we'll get our matrix around it. So I've just put it on the mesial first because that's the tight contact. Some little, if there's bits of overhang there that are hard to manage, I don't really care. You can see we've got some blood there. Like this sort of stuff would make you freak out when you're a new dentist, because most of the time at dental school, you're not really taught that you can actually refresh the bonding. You're kind of taught that if you don't get it right the first time, that's it. You can see that I'm having a little bit of trouble getting this matrix on because I've actually got a little bit of resin that's joining the two teeth. So we've got to pick that out first, otherwise I can't get this matrix through. And then we get it through that tight mesial contact, wrap it around the tooth. There's nothing fancy here. And now I'm holding it in place. Once I got it in place, I'll use the same wedge as I had before, but now I'll be able to wedge it against that little hip. And you can see it's struggling to go through there. You may need to re-lubricate that. Okay. Now that's got a nice seal all the way around, and it's got a nice pinch off against the margin. So now you might be wondering, what do we do with all the blood? Well, we're going to clean that off, wash it, give it a really good wash, really good etch, whatever we need to clean the surface off, and then we just reapply the self-etching primer, reapply the bond, and then we're ready to go for the final layer, which is the enamel. Okay, so the bit that makes this difficult is mostly dealing with this deep margin. Thank you. See you next time.